So, we have talked about flags, we have talked about national anthems, and now it is time to talk about national crests. When it comes to symbols of countries, flags, anthems, and crests are like the Holy Trinity. In fact, half the time countries put their national flag on their national crest, or put their national crest on their national flag, so the two are basically inseparable. You also find national crests on passports and government websites, and sometimes even as decorations in government buildings. So let's talk about national crests, right after I tell you that today's video was brought to you by our friends at Skillshare. This idea that every country has to have its own national crest is part of the legacy of the late 19th century movement of civic nationalism, in which it became expected for all countries of the world to express their patriotism in various standardized ways. And who set those standards? Why, the monarchies of Europe, of course, who believe themselves to embody the perfect pinnacle of nationhood that every other country in the world should copy. People often forget that this whole international system of all of the countries of the world having a very specific set of patriotic symbols is really quite arbitrary. I mean, why do we expect every country in the world to have a flag and a patriotic song that some orchestra can play? Why don't we expect every country to have an official tribal dance or an official headdress? The answer is because flags and anthems were what the Europeans had, and the Europeans had enough power to set the rules for everybody else. And so it was with national crests. Back in the day, most countries of Europe were ruled by a royal family. That royal family would have a family crest, and that family crest would also be used as the national crest for whatever country they happened to run. Not much effort was exerted in those days to separate symbols of countries from symbols of their royalty. In fact, 100 years ago, most Europeans would have argued that having a king or queen was an essential part of nationhood as well. Europeans even used to, like, make sticker books of kings and queens of the world in the same way that we might make sticker books of flags of the world today. But anyway, a crest of a European family is called a coat of arms. This is a sort of weird term that I believe dates back to the medieval times, when knights would put a crest of a family on their actual coats. That way it would be clear on whose side they were fighting. You can find a lot of military symbolism on coats of arms done up in the traditional European style. The most notable being the shield, which is still the primary component of most European coats of arms. In some countries, in fact, they still only use a shield as their national crest. Some good examples would be Ireland, Switzerland, Lithuania, and Slovenia. But in most European countries, the shield is only one part of the design, which is surrounded by a bunch of other decorations. Adding a big crown on top is pretty common, as we can see in the crests of Holland and Spain and Belgium and Denmark. The Europeans are also fond of this idea of having two animals on either side of the shield holding it up. The ones you see most often are lions, which are an ancient symbol of European royalty. Countries that were at one time colonies of the Europeans tend to have their national crest done up in the traditional European coat of arms style. But the fun twist is that instead of lions, many of these countries use animals that are native to their part of the world. So the Malaysian crest has tigers, the Australian crest has a kangaroo, Zimbabwe has a springbok, French Guiana has an anteater, and so on. Many of the monarchies of Eastern Europe base their crest around an eagle. The eagle has been a longtime symbol of Christian civilization since the time of Charlemagne, who stole it from the Roman Empire. Today, you can see eagle-based crests in places like Serbia, Poland, Austria, and of course, Germany. Bird-based crests are also popular in the Middle East, where birds of prey are a symbol associated with Muhammad. As a result, countries like Syria, Egypt, Jordan, and Dubai all have hawk-based crests. In total, I would estimate that about half of the world's national crests are based on the European coat of arms idea in some form or another. But what about the rest? Well, when America and France cut their ties to monarchy in the 18th century, they created a new tradition of national crests that we could call the Republican Seal. The idea was that instead of some old-fashioned shield and crown type dealy honoring a royal family, a properly Republican country should have a circular crest full of a bunch of symbols of democratic government. So in America, you have the famous crest with the good old American bald eagle and the stars and the stripes, and he's holding, you know, the olive branch and the arrows in his hands. These all represent various ideas about the American government. And in France, they have Marianne, who is this fictional character representing the French motherland, and she is sitting on a throne of the people surrounded by various patriotic knickknacks. When other countries became republics, they often copied the French and American tradition of the Republican seal. A lot of countries in Latin America have crests like this. For example, Argentina, Guatemala, El Salvador, and Paraguay. This tradition also proved popular in the communist world. After the Russian Revolution in 1917, the Soviets came up with this whole new style of making Republican seals, full of all this new imagery associated with communist economics. This tends to involve like wheat and gears and red stars and stuff like this. This was the seal of the old USSR, and here's the one used by China today, and Vietnam, and Laos. Many post-communist countries still have a national seal that was done up in the communist style, even if they have toned down the overt commie references a bit. For example, this was the seal of Uzbekistan then versus Uzbekistan today, or Tajikistan then versus Tajikistan now. The Italians, weirdly enough, also have a very communist-y looking seal. This was adopted in 1948, right after the Italian monarchy was deposed. So I don't know, maybe there was a bit of revolutionary spirit in the air. But then there is this whole other group of countries whose national crest doesn't really conform to any clear tradition. These are often countries without much of a history of European colonization, or countries that have just put a lot of effort into developing a very unique and distinctive style of national pride. A good example would be the Japanese, who just use this as their national crest. This is a stylized chrysanthemum flower, which is a symbol of the Emperor of Japan. Even though we often think of the Japanese Emperor as just being like a monarch in the European sense, a lot of Japanese people think of him as occupying this very distinctive Japanese office that does not have an equivalent anywhere else in the world. So it makes sense that they would use his symbol as their crest. Saudi Arabia and Oman both use these interesting symbols as their crest. As you can see, they both feature crossed swords. Scimitar-style swords are, of course, a very common cultural symbol in the Arab world. Thailand just uses this guy as their crest. His name is Garuda, and he is a Hindu deity associated with their Buddhist monarchy for reasons I don't entirely understand. But it's just as well, because in India, they use this guy as their national crest, the Lion of Sarnath, and he is a symbol of Buddhism. Ethiopia's crest is this circle with a star in the middle. This is one of the famous pentacles of King Solomon, which are best known today as being a kind of occult thing. But the Ethiopians are not occultists, they just believe that their emperors are the direct descendants of the literal King Solomon. Always comes back to royalty with these things, doesn't it? The award for most complicated crest goes to Bhutan, who use this elaborate piece of Buddhist art as theirs. Kind of impressed they were able to fit it on the passport. The award for least inspired crest, however, goes to Turkey, which is the only country in the world that doesn't have one. When they have to use something, they just use the star and crescent moon from their flag, which would be fine if that symbol wasn't also used on a whole bunch of other countries' national flags, making it completely useless as a Turkish identifier. Old man Erdogan was supposed to get around to designing a distinctive Turkish crest back in 2014, but I haven't seen any news articles suggesting that he actually did. Let me know if this ever went anywhere, Turkish friends. Now, I'm sure that after seeing all of these lovely patriotic crests, you're eager to try your hand at designing one of your own. And who better to teach you how to do that than our wonderful video sponsor, Skillshare. Good old Skillshare is a wonderful website that features over 27,000 video tutorials that can teach you how to do just about anything, including tons of classes on graphic design. I was wondering if there was a good Skillshare class on how to design a coat of arms, and of course there was. It is actually a really popular class taught by this wacky guy called Aaron Draplin, best known as the guy behind these cool little field note notebooks. Aaron's class is really cool in the way Skillshare courses often are, with high production values, well-structured lessons, and of course tons of helpful information. Look, it was so useful I was even able to design a new crest for Turkey. Anyway, if you want to get started learning with Skillshare, just sign up using the link in the thing below. You can get 2 free months of unlimited access to the website and all of the glories within. If you're someone who likes to learn, you should really give it a try. So yes, national crests is a big topic, and yet I feel as if I have barely scratched the surface. Let me know in the comments if you have any fun facts or savage opinions on the crests and coats of arms of the world that I could maybe use in a follow-up video. Until then, I will see you all next week.